Good morning and welcome. Glad that you're here as we gather together today to worship. Whether you're here with us or watching online, we are glad that God has called us together to worship Him. And I pray that each one of us will not only encounter Him as we worship, but also be transformed as we worship Him today. And I hope that we come with an expectation that God is going to do something great during this time of worship as we seek His face. Just a couple of quick notes. The Heart Sisters is providing soup for shut-ins this coming Saturday. If you'd like to help, or if you know a shut-in who might need to receive some soup, please contact Tammy Duke by Wednesday of this week, and I know that she'll let you know what you need to do or make sure that the soup gets to whoever needs it. Also, thank you to all of you who have taken clothes to the Veterans Life Center. However, they have got more than they need at this time, so they're asking that no more clothes be brought there for the time being. And now I want to encourage us as we join together with our responsive call to worship, which will be followed by our prayer of invocation led by Gene Boone, and then we'll sing a verse of Set My Soul Afire. May God speak to each of us here in the sanctuary and at home. And let's all stand together now as we enter into this time of worship. There's one place where it'll be ladies and another place where it'll be the men. So read the lines. Jesus went to the mountain and was transformed. People of God, come to the mountain of worship and be transformed. Come, sisters in faith, to proclaim God's greatness. Come, brothers in the faith, to proclaim God's goodness. Come to the mountain to experience God's brilliance. Let us come to the mountain to meet God. Let's join together in prayer.
Let's pray. Dear Lord, we thank you for this day, for the privilege we have to get together and to worship you. Lord, you care so much for humanity that you gave us your word so that we can know you. We can know your thoughts. We know your desires and for us and your purpose. Bless us through scripture as it is read today, Lord. Speak to each one of us through the message that you have put on Charlie's heart for us today. In Jesus' name, I pray. Amen.
Good morning and happy Valentine's Day. While you're still standing, let's sing one verse of Set My Soul Afire.
Thank you.
forgot my little connector for the back, and as a result, I keep pulling my hearing aids out. Today, we're looking at a couple of events that happened on a mountain. And those events included Moses, and then also included Jesus and his disciples. But as I think about you children, I've watched you grow and change over the 7+ years that I've been here in this church as pastor. Some of you I held on the first day that you were born in the hospital, and now you're over 7 years old. And so it's been fun to watch you change. And I know over the next several years you will continue to change. But I hope there are other changes that take place rather than just what we look like or how big we are, but instead that we have changes that show that we have encountered God in our lives. In the story of Moses, he went up Mount Sinai, and he spent time with God, and when he came back, his face was bright and shiny, almost like a flashlight. And the people were afraid because they saw how bright his face was. And that was because he had been with God. And then Jesus, we look at his, what we call the Mount of Transfiguration. And in that event, not only his face, but his entire being was shining brightly, and his disciples could see how much he had changed. And in many ways, it was God showing to the disciples and ultimately to all of us who Jesus really was and who he would become. And so my prayer is that we too, as Christians, will be lights shining in the darkness, that we won't be just a light on a phone, but that we'll be a light that when people see us, like the people saw Moses and saw that he looked different. When the disciples saw Jesus, they saw that he looked different. And I hope and pray that when people see you in the years to come, that you too will be different because God has been working and moving in your life. Let's pray together. Father, I thank you for the children of this church, for their parents and their grandparents. And I pray, Lord, that you might be with each one of them. And if they have not already received Christ as their Savior, that one day they will. But in the meantime, I pray that you would watch over them and keep them safe. Help the parents and the grandparents as they seek to help their children, their grandchildren, come to know Christ in a personal way. And Lord, I do pray that others will be able to see Jesus living in and through them throughout their lives. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
If you would stand again, and we'll sing two verses of Higher Ground.
As we come to our time of prayer concerns, we do want to remember the family of Virginia Adcock, who passed away on Thursday. The family will receive friends tomorrow from 12 to 1:30 at Eakes in Creedmoor, and then there'll be a graveside service for her at Elmwood Cemetery in Oxford at 2 o'clock. Also remember May Ray and her family with the passing of her son-in-law, Ron Brooks. Donald James will be having a heart catheterization done tomorrow, so be in prayer for him and for the medical team. Barbara Whitlow will be having her hip replacement surgery done again on March the 1st, so be in prayer for her. And just as a note with that, due to Barbara's health, Derry has stepped aside as a deacon this year, and so Stacy Askew is now serving as chairperson of the deacons. Philip Duke is the vice chair of the deacons. So we hate that, but with Barbara's health, Derry just didn't feel like he could serve in the way that he would like. Chris Emery is home recovering from her hip surgery and doing well. Don Daniels is improving. He has several doctor's appointments this week, so be in prayer for him. Hospice has been called in for Nanette Carpenter, so be in prayer for her and her family. Donna Simsprott has lung cancer, but she's not a candidate for treatment, so be in prayer for her. Bill Birdsong's dialysis, they've been having a few issues, so they're adjusting the meds, and hopefully things will get a little bit better as that goes forward. Judy Yates has asked us to pray for her doctor's wisdom in helping her with her situation. Nancy Rogers did have some complications from her recent breast surgery, and so she'll be going back to the doctor this Tuesday, so be in prayer for her concerning that. Alvin Gates, who is also under hospice care at Bryan Center at South Point, and then also Bob Conrad is not recovering as quickly or as well as they would like, so be in prayer for him. Also continue to remember Brenda Adcock and Arthur and Maxine Bird, just for their general health. Let's pray together. Father, it's so good to come into this place. To be able to be still and allow you to be God. Oftentimes we're so busy that we don't stop and appreciate the relationship that we have with you. We don't appreciate all the many things that you do in our lives. But we do indeed come to you now and thank you for your presence in this place. And I pray, Lord, that you might make your presence felt in all the homes where this service is being watched. I pray, Lord, that you might be with each of these concerns that we have mentioned. Lord, I pray for Dennis and all the family of Miss Virginia. But I also pray for our church as we'll miss her smile and her laughter. And I pray, Lord, that you might be not only with the family, but also with us as her church family. And Lord, we pray for Miss May and the loss of her son-in-law. We pray that you might comfort each one of them and that family in a very special way. God, for Donald, we pray that you be with him tomorrow as he undergoes his heart cath. And we pray, Lord, that it will not show any complications. But if it does, I pray that you give wisdom and guidance to the medical staff as they do this procedure. Lord, we pray that you would be with Barbara and prepare her for her surgery on March the 1st. Pray that you'd be with Derry as he cares for her needs during these days as well. God, continue to be with Miss Chris and have your hand of healing upon her as she recovers from her fall and her surgery. Lord, we thank you that Don Daniel is doing better, and we just pray that you continue to be with him. Be with he and LaRue as they travel to doctor's appointments this week. Lord, we pray for Nanette and for Reggie and for all their family during this very difficult time, as they know that her life will not last a whole lot longer. But I pray, Lord, that they might feel your comfort and your peace. I pray for Donna and Bill and Judy and Nancy as they deal with health issues, that you might touch them and heal them if it could be your will. We pray, Lord, that you might use the medical people and the medications that they might be able to get better. And Lord, we pray also for Alvin and for his family in this time as he goes through this end of life as well. And God be with Bob and Brenda and Arthur and Maxine during these days. Help them to feel your presence and your peace. And God, I just pray now that as we go through the remainder of this hour, that everything we say and everything we do would glorify and honor you. But I pray also, Father, that each one of us might be challenged by the music and the message as we consider our encounters with you. And I pray, Lord, that each one of us will be transformed when we come into your presence. For I pray these things in Christ's powerful and holy name. Amen.
Thank you. I will be reading from Exodus chapter 34, verses 29 through 35. When Moses came down from Mount Sinai with the two tablets of the testimony in his hands, he was not aware that his face was radiant because he had spoken with the Lord. When Aaron and all the Israelites saw Moses, his face was radiant, and they were afraid to come near him. But Moses called to them. So Aaron and the leaders of the community came back to him, and he spoke to them. Afterward, all the Israelites came near him, and he gave them all the commands the Lord had given him on Mount Sinai. When Moses finished speaking to them, he put a veil over his face. And whenever he entered the Lord's presence to speak with him, he removed the veil until he came out. And when he came out and told the Israelites what he had been commanded, they saw that his face was radiant. Then Moses put the veil back over his face until he went to speak with the Lord.
I'll be reading from Luke 9, 28 through 36. About 8 days after Jesus said this, he took Peter, John, and James with him and went up to the mountain to pray. As he was praying, the appearance of his face changed, and his clothes became as bright as a flash of lightning. Two men, Moses and Elijah, appeared in glorious splendor to be talking with Jesus. They spoke about his departure, which he was about to bring to fulfillment at Jerusalem. Peter and his companions were very sleepy, but when they became fully awake, they saw his glory and the two men standing with him. As the men were leaving Jesus, Peter said to him, "Master, it is good for us to be here. Let us put up three shelters, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah." He did not know what he was saying. While he was speaking, a cloud appeared and enveloped them. They were afraid as they entered the cloud. A voice came from the cloud saying, "This is my son, whom I have chosen. Listen to him." When the voice had spoken, they found out that Jesus was alone. The disciples kept this to themselves and told no one at that time what they had seen.
Jim, thank you for the special today, and Dennis and Raina for reading our scripture for us. Some would have perhaps thought that I'd be preaching on love with it being Valentine's Day. But this, and I'm not following the church year completely or as far as the lectionary goes, but this is Transformation Sunday. We celebrate when Christ went to the mountain and was transformed. But it wasn't just Jesus who was transformed at that mountain. For the disciples were also transformed. They too were changed. Our appearance does indeed make a difference, whether for good or for bad. Now, I'm probably one of the few in the world who has never watched an episode of Friends. I'm sure many of you, if not all of you, have watched it. Late at night, I'll be already in bed and I'll hear Trish and Russ back there in the den laughing, watching Friends, so I'm sure that it's funny. But on one particular episode that I have read of, Ross had a new girlfriend and he wanted to impress her. And so he bought some tooth whitener, but he left it on his teeth twice as long as he was supposed to. He went over to his girlfriend's house and he said, "Do you notice anything different?" She said, "Not really." Well, later on, they turned the lights down so they could watch television, and all of a sudden she screams. Because when he smiles, his teeth are glowing in the dark. He made a little bit more of an impression than he would have liked, didn't he? But in a sense, that's what happened with the people when Moses came down from the mountain. They were afraid. They were fearful because they did not understand why he had such a glow about him, why he looked the way that he did. And in some ways, they were focusing more on the way that he looked than what he was sharing with them. And so today, I want us to look at Moses' encounter, Jesus and the disciples' encounter, and our encounter. In the passage that Raina read for us today in Exodus chapter 34, we read of how Moses went up on the Mount Sinai. And if we read a little bit earlier in that chapter, we will find that he was there for 40 days and 40 nights. And so he is meeting with God. Now we know that it was a time in which he came back with the Ten Commandments from having met with God to share with them what God wanted them to know. But during that time, something happened to Moses. He was changed. But why was he changed? Was it because he had not eaten for 40 days, as the scriptures tell us? Was it because he had been up on a mountain and perhaps he had been closer to the sun? Or was it the fact that he had been in God's presence? I believe that Moses was changed because he was with God, because he encountered him during that time while he was there on the mountain. And there's something important about the change that Moses experienced. The people were able to see the difference in Moses. Yes, it frightened them, but they could see that there was something different about him. Moses knew that it was because he had been in God's presence. And it's important for us to remember that when we have encountered God, people should be able to see a difference in us as well. But Moses encountered God on the mountain, and his life was changed. Jesus went up to the mountain, but prior to going up there, he had asked his disciples, "Who is it that people are saying that I am?" And they gave him two or three answers of what people were saying. And then finally he says to Peter, "But who do you say that I am?" And we know it was here that Peter confessed him as the Christ, the Son of the living God. But at that moment, just prior to when he went up onto the Mount of Transfiguration, as we call it, Jesus shared with him that he was about to suffer. He was about to go to Jerusalem and he was about to give his life. He was going to die. But he said something else to those disciples in those verses just prior to what Dennis read for us this morning. He said to them, "If you want to follow me, you have to take up your cross, deny yourself." And I like the fact that Luke says daily. And then we can follow him. Even before Jesus went and Peter and James and John could see him for who he really was, he had already begun to challenge them that they needed to live in the same way. And as our scripture told us, and I noticed that Dennis stop for just a moment as well, because I've always said Peter, James, and John, but Luke here said Peter, John, and James, which is a little different order. But he lets us know who the ones who were, who went up and were present with him on the Mount of Transfiguration. I find it interesting as you read that passage of scripture that they were sleepy Does that remind you of any other situation where Jesus took some of them to the garden and they fell asleep? And oftentimes we are that way. We miss out on what God wants us to see and know and hear because we're sleeping through it. Maybe not physically, but Peter and James and John are there. And while they are there, they look after they are fully awake and they see that Jesus is not standing alone, but that Moses and Elijah are also there with him. In this passage, I believe that Moses represents the law that was given at Mount Sinai. I believe that Elijah represents the prophets who foretold of Christ's coming. And I believe here on the Mount of Transfiguration, Jesus represents God in all of his glory because the disciples saw him as radiant and full. But I also believe that Jesus' identity or his appearance identifies who he is. I believe that it identifies him with the Father because the Father will indeed speak and call him his Son. But I believe also that Jesus' appearance here shows him as identifying as the Savior of the world, the one who had just foretold that he was about to die. But I also believe that with Moses and Elijah there on either side, that it represents that Jesus is also the fulfillment of the law and of the prophets. And God speaks. He identifies Jesus as his Son. He identifies Jesus as his chosen one, the one who will be the Savior of the world. He identifies Jesus, and God speaks to them and tells the disciples to do what? To listen to what Jesus has to say. Now, what was the response of the disciples? I believe first they were afraid. And they really couldn't comprehend all that was happening and taking place at that moment in time. But once they had finally come fully awake and they had witnessed this, did you notice what good old Peter spoke? And as a passage read in the NIV said, he didn't know what he was saying. And I wonder how often that's true of you and me as well. We think we're speaking well, but instead we are not really saying what we ought to say. But once they had done that, they decided that they wanted to stay and they wanted to build a shrine for Jesus and Moses and Elijah. But Jesus wouldn't allow it, would he? Because Jesus knew that he still had a mission to fulfill that would not take place on the mountain, but would take place down in the valley. And so the disciples go back into the world. But I don't believe they were ever the same. They, like Mary, after the angel had appeared to her, pondered all these things in her heart, I think they did the same. It says they didn't tell anyone. But I don't believe they were ever the same, because I believe that they were changed by this encounter of seeing Jesus for who he really is. He was no longer just their teacher. He was no longer just their provider. But now they were beginning to understand that he would also be their Savior, that he was the Messiah who had been foretold for years and for years. And so I want to move to the third and, to me, the most important part of this message. What happens to you? What happens to me? When you have an encounter with God, when I have an encounter with God, is there any change that takes place? Are our lives different than they were before? I believe that when we encounter God, we will be like Moses, and we too shall never be the same. Our lives will be different. Our countenance, if you would, will be changed. Do any of you ever remember perhaps one of your parents saying to you, okay, what's wrong? What, you look guilty. Or a mom saying to her daughter, okay, who is he? I can tell that look. All of us give away much of what we are through our face and through our expressions, don't we? It was Moses' face that was glowing. And we too must be changed. Our lives must be different. People must see something different in us than they see in others. We may think at times it doesn't really matter. Story about a young lady who was in college, and she would go home on the weekends, and part of what they did on Friday night, she and her family, was to provide food, the concession stand, if you would, for the local auction that took place on every Friday night. Well, she said there was one particular lady that every Friday before they opened up came and said, can I have a cup of coffee? Well, on this particular Friday night, it just really bugged her and irritated her that this lady had shown up before they were open. And she began to make some faces as she thought about this. And all of a sudden, she heard the lady say, Marilyn, Marilyn, I can see the faces that you're making, because she had removed the cardboard at the front. And she was looking at her. The point being is, we never know when someone is watching us and who will see us in the way that we live our lives. And so I pray that when we encounter God, we will first of all not be the same, even as Moses was not the same. And so when you encounter God, are you being changed? Or is your life staying the same? We should never be the same person when we have had an encounter with God. But also, when we encounter God, we, like Jesus, should begin to be transformed into the person that God wants us to be. Now, we will never fully get there, but each encounter should lead us to be transformed a little bit more and a little bit more, until we become more and more into the likeness of God. And so I ask you, as I ask myself, are we being transformed? Are we being transformed when we come into the presence of God? Will this encounter with God during this hour, whether here in the sanctuary or online, will we be transformed because we've come into the presence of God? We may not be transformed because of the preacher. We may not be transformed because of the music, but when we come into the presence of God, we need to be transformed, and we will be transformed if we come with the expectation that he can move and work in our hearts and our lives. Just as Moses was not the same, neither were the disciples the same. When they came down from that mountain, they were different than when they had gone up that mountain, weren't they? When we come in to worship God, when we go into our prayer closets, when we read God's word, when we encounter him and these and other places, do we come away as a different person? Are we becoming the person that God wants us to be? Different from what we have been, becoming what he wants us and the direction that he wants us to go. But too often we simply come into worship, or we go and read our scriptures, or we go into our time of prayer and just go through the motions, not really expecting to have an encounter with God, not really expecting God to change our lives and transform us, but we ought to. Jesus once said, you have not because you ask not. Are we asking God to transform us? Are we asking God to make us into a different person than we have been in the past? Are we growing and becoming the person that God wants us to be? And even though we did not read the passage of scripture about Jacob, but you remember the encounter that he had with God in Genesis chapter 32. When he walked away from that place after he had his wrestling match with God. Jacob walked differently, didn't he? When we have an encounter with God, when God touches us, do we walk differently? Is our life being changed and renewed by our relationship and our encounters with God? For you see, we will know that that is taking place. Because like the people who saw Moses could tell, like the disciples who saw Jesus could tell, when we encounter God, go to the next slide. There we go. Others should see the change in us because we have been with God. We have been touched by God and we walk differently. I'm so thankful that the people from my high school and early college days, that when we encounter one another now, they see that I'm different than I was back then. Oh, I've still got a long ways to go to be transformed to where God wants me to be. But when they look at my life, they can at least see a difference. They can see that God has done some changing. God has done some work in my life. And so do others see the transformation in your life because you have encountered God, because you have been with Him. But there's one other thing that I want to remind us of. When we encounter God, we should not stay on the mountain, but instead we should go back into the valley and share God's light where there's darkness. I can relate to Peter, can't you? I'm sure all of us have been in, experienced a time, whether it being a worship service or some small group or something, that we have just truly felt the presence of God in our midst. And we don't want it to end. We want it to keep on going and you keep on going. And that's kind of what Peter wanted to do. He wanted to hold on to that mountaintop experience. But Jesus would not allow him to remain there, and God will not allow us to remain on the mountaintop. Not that he doesn't want us to experience him over and over again, but he knows that we need to go back into the valley. Back in 1963, when Martin Luther King was preaching in Memphis, his last sermon that he preached, let me get the right title. Was entitled, I See the Promised Land. And during that message, he said, I've been to the mountain. I've been to the mountain and I've seen God's glory. And he said, now I'm ready to go back into the valley to get back to work. Little did he or anyone else know that was listening to him on that day, that the very next day he would be shot and killed because of what he had been doing, of trying to seek equal rights for all people. But he encapsulated what we need to do as well. That we need to be willing to go back to the valley. To go back and share the light that God has given to us. The way in which God has made a difference in our lives. And so I want to conclude with a couple of questions a verse of scripture, and then a statement. First, I want to ask each one of us, have we had an encounter with God? Robert Louis Stevenson shared a story about a time when there were a number of people on a large ship. And they were caught in a really bad storm, and they were all fearful for their lives. And so he shares of how one of the passengers made his way to where the captain was. Well, the captain was very serious and working hard to make sure that the ship stayed safe. But when he saw the passenger, he immediately looked up and smiled at him and said, "We're going to be okay." Well, this passenger went back to the others and said, "We're going to be okay. I've seen the face of the pilot, and he has showed me that we would be okay." When we encounter God, we have looked into the face of the pilot, and our lives can be changed and transformed. And so I ask the second question, are we being transformed by God? Is our Christian walk any different today than it was 6 months ago, or a year ago, or 5 years ago, or last week? Is God transforming our lives, making us into the person that He wants us to be? For you see, encountering God and being transformed go hand in hand. We cannot encounter God without being transformed. We cannot be transformed without encountering God. And so are we allowing our encounters to transform us? Are we avoiding encounters with God? But I want you to know that God is at work, and God will make a difference in our lives. On the opening slide, it had a part of a verse that was there. Ephesians 3:20, this particular slide has it in the New Living Translation. "Now all glory to God, who is able, through His mighty power at work within us, to accomplish infinitely more than we could ever ask for or think about." God can transform us in ways that we never thought of, ways that we've never asked for. Not because of who we are, but because of the power that He has and the power that He works in and through our lives. But we have to let Him work. And so I want to conclude with this thought. If you have encountered God, let God work in and through you. Too many of us want to hold on to God working in us, but we are saved so that we might share the good news with others. The disciples were told to come down from the mountain, not so that they could come back to the valley, but so that they could share with others in the valley who Christ was. Allow Him to work in you, but also allow Him to work through you. And I challenge you as I challenge myself. Never be content with who you are as a Christian. Never be content with where you are in your Christian walk, on your Christian journey. But continue to allow God to transform you into the person that He wants you to be. Be transformed by the renewing of your hearts and lives. He will do that. He wants to do that. Let others see Christ shining through you. We have all seen young ladies who are getting ready to be married. And I've spoken of how they glow. I've seen young ladies who are expecting a child, and there's just a different look about them. Not just the belly, but in the face as well. And that's what God wants from us. We need to have that glow that others will want, what we have. We need to have that look that says to others, I have experienced God's love. I've experienced God's saving power, and I want to share that with you. If we truly want to celebrate Valentine's Day, then be transformed by God's love and share that love with others. Because Jesus said, the two greatest commandments are these: love the Lord and love your neighbor. If we've been transformed, we will do both. It's not an either or, it's a both and. Let's pray together. God, I thank you so much for the many encounters that I've had with you over the years. I confess to you that many times I've not allowed those encounters to change me, to transform me, to help me to be the person that you want me to be. But I pray today, Lord, that each of us who have been in this place and watching online can truly say that we have encountered you today, that you have touched us, you have changed us, you have transformed us, and we walk differently. God, give us a glow about ourselves, not to draw attention to ourselves, but instead to draw attention to you. Because you are a great, a good, and a loving God. And it's in your Son's name that we pray. Amen. Just a moment, we're going to stand together and sing our closing hymn, Just As I Am. We're going to sing three verses today, 1, 2, and 4. They'll be up on the screen, of course, for you. But if God has spoken to you, right where you are, make a commitment to him that I want to be renewed and transformed each and every day of my life. I want to encounter you more and more in my life. If you need to talk with me, feel free to do so, whether here, over the phone, or however you might want to get in touch with me. But let God change you as Moses was changed, as the disciples were changed. Let's be changed. Let's stand together and sing, Just As I Am. Know that Moses looks a whole lot like Charlton Heston
even on my tie. It's good to hear you laugh, but it's also good that we've had the opportunity to come into God's presence, isn't it? Let's join together now for our benediction. And now, Father, as we go from this place, I pray, Lord, that we have met you. We have been touched. We have been transformed. And we will go out into the valley to share your light with others. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.